It's a very picturesque town. The people are immensely friendly, and there was a good crowd in today, so the whole venture was quite comfortable.
Why do you think that Thunderbirds is one that still lives in people's hearts and imaginations all these decades later?
You know, people are still asking that. Because when we started it, it just seemed like, certainly on my part, it was just another job, and we didn't know where it was going or whether it was going to last a week or a month or whatever it was going to do. We got paid £20 a session. Not a lot of money, was it? But that was what the going rate was then for something that had no bankable sort of future to it. All of a sudden, overnight, things started to happen, and Thunderbirds became an international hit, and nobody was more surprised than we were. I mean, it was amazing. What I will say about Gerry Anderson, whoever did whatever in the Thunderbird situation was the best. Derek Meddings and Tony Barwick and these sort of people were the best he could possibly get. And that makes a difference because although it was a puppet show and it was a kiddie show for the main part, although not entirely, the quality was striking. And this is what people came to really appreciate. And we appreciated it, too, as people who were doing it. The strips were good. There was no nonsense about having to make things up because it didn't really sound right. So all in all, it was quite an immense product to be associated with. And, of course, the more it grew around, it went right around the world and gained an immense sort of, excuse me, reputation, and all of which we very much appreciated.
Another icon that you were lucky enough to work with was Mr. Stanley Kubrick with Dr. Strangelove. I guess he's such an enigmatic and important figure in cinema. What were your personal experiences like of Stanley?
Kubrick, you know, for a long time had the studios in Hollywood did not really appreciate Kubrick. They knew he was a winner, but they never knew what he was going to do. He was the most unpredictable producer going. And so they hired him. They contracted him to do a lot of big pictures. But they never knew and held their breath when he went into production what was going to happen. Usually it was pretty good. He just had an innate knowledge of how to make a picture work. And some of the people were lined up. The biggest stars in Hollywood were lined up to work for him. They didn't care what the money was. They just wanted to work for Kubrick. He was a lovely man. I remember just at the beginning of the production, I mean, he had people like Peter Sellers, George C. Scott, Keenan Wynn. I mean, these chaps could start revolutions. I mean, they were really quite extraordinary. The firepower that they had between them was immense. He somehow managed to have the meeting out of his hand. They just appreciated this incredible talent and also the understanding he had. He said, if you got a problem, don't try to solve it yourself if it's too difficult. Come to me, we'll work it out. I mean, this is very unusual for a Hollywood director. They just want to get the picture over with and give themselves as many kudos as possible. But Kubrick was a man's man.
Of all the remarkable pieces of cinema he gave us, why do you think Dr. Strangelove is so often hailed as one of his finest and most enduring, timeless achievements?
It broke a lot of rules. And I think that was it. It also had this immense cast who never let up. I mean, they had a good script to work with, but they fed off each other. I've never seen a group of actors who gave so much to each other. And nobody was trying to be a star, even Sellers, who was accused sometimes of doing that. They were just handing things to each other to pick up the baton and get to that finish line. And it worked. I mean, it was mesmerizing, the work that he turned out. It really was.
It doesn't get any bigger than Bond, and of course you were a part of that wonderful legacy as well. Can you talk about your fondest memories of working on that, and why you think Bond continues to endure so remarkably?
Yeah, it is quite remarkable. I came over, my timing was pretty good. It's usually not as good as this. And Britain was knocking out superlative products week after week after month after month. They were right at the very top of their game. I met Barbara Broccoli, and somehow we got along pretty well. You know, when you're contacting somebody and you make sense to each other. Well, I think that's what happened. So I got the role of Captain Carter, and it was the third appearance I did for the Bond people. And with Roger. I worked for both Connery and Roger Moore. Connery you never fooled around with. I mean, things were strictly right down the line, and whatever the script called for, that's what you gave them. Roger, I mean, you really didn't know what was going to happen until the end of the day. He just loved to caper about. He was a good actor. There was no doubt about that. But you couldn't come in the same door that Connery came in with this incredible sort of presence he had. So Roger came in another door. He became articulate. Well, he always was pretty articulate. And he had this immense sort of charm that he used superlatively. So he wasn't doing a Connery, but he had to make up some sort of character that was going to penetrate the movie, and he did, and that's how he survived. I forget how many pictures he did, but it was quite a lot. And he was good. He had that sort of veneer that people in the spy business, the international spy business, had to have. They had to ride over every possible difficulty that came up, and he did. I couldn't imagine who was going to take over that role. And I think maybe the Broccolis are playing it the right way. They don't want to commit themselves. And they're sitting in the easy chair. Everybody is doing their going through their paces. And they've got a front row seat as to who they think. They're the ones who know how the Bond should work. They're the only ones who can do it. So a lot of speculation really doesn't amount to a hill of beans. Whoever it is will be a good one. You can bank on that.